y'all is Lee Atwater. That's right. Lee Atwater, the architect of the Southern strategy. You know, when I'm not burning off my ass in hell or putting up with that goddamn Andrew Bratbop, I'm listening to Netroots Radio on netrootsradio.com. You know, even though the wireless signal is disrupted because of the heat down here, we still get a little bit of it.
Okay. Wednesday. Wednesday edition of Jibber Jabber. Wink with you tonight. Great. You know, kind of a rainy day. Grizzly kind of drizzle today out there in New York. Drove around all the freaking central New York, I think, today looking for stuff that I could not find. So I wasted about 4 hours doing that today. Yes. Yes, yes. I still, you know, I blame Google Maps, of course. They sent me in the wrong direction. But, you know, we'll figure it out. I'm going to have to send them some information on how I figured it out. But that's neither here nor there. 417-717-1454. Suffice it to say, I'm getting to know Boonville, which is not in New York 21. Boonville, New York, pretty good. That little tiny town, but... that's that. Also, of course, in the chat tonight, just go to netrootsradio.com. Scroll down the bottom of the page, and on the right-hand side of the bottom of the page, there is a link to the chat, so click that. Join us in the chat. It's the best way to do it. And if you're on Skype, you want to get on the show tonight, and you're on Skype, just Skype us, as they say, at netroots.radio is the way to do that. Flynn, we've got the Trumpster, we got all these things going on inside the White House and inside the administration. I'm thinking, you know, the over-under, what are we going to move the over-under for this administration to maybe December of this year? I don't know. Maybe something like that. I don't know if it's going to make it to Christmas or not. I really don't see it happening. It could be good news for the Democrats if they play it right, and we generally don't. Give us the golden chalet or whatever, we just turn it into mud. So, you know, whatever. It's just, we just, every time, you get something in your hands like this, and somebody's bound to mess it up. Just, I don't know. Let the rank and file, try to work it out, and probably work out pretty good, but you got the, lifelong Democrats in the, inside the Beltway, and they go, oh, no. We've been doing this for 40 years. We know what we're doing. Well, yeah, okay. All right. Yeah, you've proven that. I don't know. We'll probably screw it up. I think we got 2018 pretty much handed to us, you know, with a bow. You know, there's a bow, too, to add that to there. But, like I say, we'll just somehow blow it. We'll just blow it somehow. Always do. We thought we had it sewn up with Kerry. And what, 2004, and then that kind of, yeah, that's all through too. So there's always something. I mean, they got, you know, the Republicans, they got more dirty tricks up their sleeves than you can, you know, shake a stick at, as they say. So I don't know if we're going to take advantage of all these blunders or not, but seems to me we could, if we chose to. I've got to get this music down, just a kitty whisker. But yeah, that's pretty much, you know, I mean, I think it's, this is all Democrats all the time for 2018 if we play these cards right, which I don't, you know, we never would, like I say, we never do, so, I don't know, I get my hopes up, and I say, we got three aces, this, that, and the other thing, and still, you know, the pair of deuces that the Republicans got will beat our three aces, no question about it. They got nothing, they really got nothing, so I don't know how they survive it. But they always do. They always end up looking good, no matter how good our hand looks. They can beat us with a pair of deuces. That's how it works. Democrats always kind of screw up their end, it seems like. 417-717-1454. We had Angie of Washington State on today. She had some great stuff, too, earlier today on the after show, kicking it off at 11 a.m. Eastern time. And, yeah, it's great to have her on. Awesome. Got Gina Brown. Got a little bit from Gina Brown tonight, too, so we'll get that on there, too. Like, you know, if I don't screw that up, I'll probably screw it up, but we'll try not to. What else I got? I got nothing else. We'll get over to the GOS. Maybe if I can find out how to do that. Yeah, okay. Let me see what we got here. I want to turn this down just a kitty whisker, too, while I'm at it, I guess. I don't know. Yeah. Do that, do that, do that, do this, do, do, do. I need one more pair of hands here, and I'll be all set. That looks good. Okay, okay, okay. Okay. I guess that's it. I don't know. Looks all right. Let's see here. Okay. We got the right one? Yeah, we do. Okay. Yeah, my meter blades tonight with the open thread for Night Owls. What is EPA hating Scott Pruitt hiding in 1,000s of withheld emails? Well, we know what he's hiding. I mean, you know, we don't have to really ask that question, but yeah, it makes for a good story regardless. it's amazing that the Trumpster, well, not amazing because this is obviously part of the playbook, but the Trumpster's gone. And pretty much any department you want to talk about, Department of Education, Department of this, Department of that, doesn't matter. Any department head that he's appointing here is pretty much all about disabling his own department once he gets in there, once he gets, you know, gets through the proper procedures and, you know, the Hail Marys and all the stuff he's got to go through and get, I mean, you know, once he gets the job, or she gets the job, in the case of Betsy, billionaire DeVos, you know, I mean, there's just the intent to destroy their own freaking department, you know, reduce it to the size of a turd and flush it right down the toilet. There you go. I'm done. Thank you for playing, everybody, and I'm out of here. It took me 2 years, but we got it done. This department is toast. Thank you. And another part of the federal government, toast, and you got, whatever, I don't know, 7-8 departments, whatever we got. All done. They'll all be down to pretty much two employees if they got that. Two federal employees, maybe, possibly, maybe not. But the intent is to obviously dismantle the departments they had. Meteor Blaze MB points that out. Scott Pruitt no doubt hopes the agency he has been designated to run will no longer exist by 2018, no question. You know, he's given it 2 years and done. I think everybody's plan is to get it 2 years and out. Department of Education, DeVos will have that done in 2 years. Done. No, there's no sense having a Department of Education because all of our educational facilities and such have been privatized, damn it. So why do we need this department? We're closing it down. Done. Take it. Take that. And no, we don't need no federal freaking, agenda for these schools. It's just we've got our own plan for these schools. Thank you very much. And we don't need no help from the federal government. Which, by the way, we just flushed that department down the toilet. Thank you. it's going to be like that. So that's what we're going to be watching here in another 3, 4, 5, 6 months on CNN or whatever, some cable net that's still on the air, possibly. Or we might be reporting it ourselves right now. We might be the only ones left, I don't know. Martha Roberts at the Environmental Defense Fund writes, what is Scott Pruitt hiding? Thousands of withheld emails, yet another reason his EPA nomination should be stopped. But won't be, okay? But won't be. Scott Pruitt, President Trump's pick for the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, is withholding thousands of emails related to his ties to major energy interests who may have donated to his political cause as well. Not may. Did. Have. And are still donating. Such stonewalling makes it difficult for senators to vote on his nomination since they can't know if these contacts were appropriate. But I think, you know, they're smart enough. I think they can guess Do we actually need the paperwork on this? I think they can guess. I think I'd say, sir, I think your crap here is just inappropriate. And therefore, we're not going to vote for your ass. Thank you very much for playing. But no, it's not going to happen. It is particularly disturbing because Pruitt, who as EPA administrator would be charged with overseeing vital clean air and clean water protections, has a long history of opposing bedrock safeguards in concert with industry players. Yeah, there's no doubt about that. I mean, obviously, favors the industry people, the coal people, you know, coal, oil, all that stuff right there. So, yeah, they're going to definitely be way ahead of any kind of protections. Don't need no protections, thank you. Center for Media and Democracy filed a report Tuesday about the absent emails with an Oklahoma court, the latest chapter in the watchdog group's two-year saga to get a response to its requests for records from Oklahoma Attorney General's office. Emergency hearing before the court has been scheduled for Thursday, February 16th, which is what, tomorrow? Or today in some parts of the U.S. of A., which on the East Coast it is tomorrow already. Yeah, so that's how that works. Pruitt's absent emails so concerned Senate Democrats that they have asked voting on Pruitt's nomination be postponed, you know, a couple of months until after the Oklahoma court holds its hearing. Meanwhile, questions surrounding Pruitt's nomination continue to grow. From who? That's from where? From where? Will continue to grow from where. In January, Environmental Defense Fund filed a Freedom of Information Act request for EPA records relating to development of Pruitt's bare-bones ethics agreement with the EPA. Unfortunately, the request to get these records swiftly in time for to inform consideration of Pruitt's nomination was rejected. You know, I mean, you could have requested. Well, they requested these things back in January, so I think they could have got them by now, but apparently not. We continue to wait for these key documents, and we're going to continue to wait and continue to wait and continue to wait, because the Trumpsters have no intention of making those available. Tweet of the day: Virgil, Texas. I love a dorks like my grandparents came legally. Yeah, that basically meant passing a lice check and not dying of cholera on the steamer. Yeah, pretty much. That's basically that. It wasn't much more than that. Make sure you stick your tongue out. Yeah, okay, you're good. No lice. Yeah, okay. No cholera. Looks like you're pretty healthy to me. Okay, sign here. Blah, 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 blah. Okay. Of course, that was 100 years ago. Today, it's a little more difficult. Not much more, I don't think. Unless, of course, you're of a particular color other than white. Then you might have a little tough time getting in here. I don't know. In Texas, being unborn gets you more protection than if you are a victim of sex trafficking. Yeah, no question. No doubt about it. Because once you are born, the right wing feather markers don't give a flying flip about your ass, okay, or protecting it. Simple as that. We've broken down abortion here many times, and with the right wing, it's abortion breaks down to sex outside of marriage, or you know, without marriage, without a marriage certificate, yada yada yada. You have to have a certificate to have any kind of sex. And some 16-year-old in the backseat of a Plymouth ain't getting it done. Damn it. Little freaking teenage bastards. So that's what it is about. It isn't about the unborn baby. I know everybody, you know, the right wing, oh, the unborn baby, the unborn baby, the unborn baby. Well, you know, if you gave a flying flip about the unborn baby, then you would actually care about it after it was actually freaking born. But no, you don't. You don't give a flying, you know, about any of that stuff. WIC checks. Nope. No WIC checks for you. Thank you. Nope. No food stamps. In fact, no food. You know, food. You go to the freaking food place there. What do they call it? The not the care. One of those food places, and you'll get a can of this and a can of that, and maybe some, I don't know, maybe an onion or something. There's your food for the day. Take that, you liberal bastard sons of bitches. The Lone Star State just loves women. Actually, it just loves trying to control women, specifically their access to health care and abortion, so much so that last year, Texas lawmakers tried to force women who have miscarriages and abortions to bury their fetal tissue. Damn it, take that. And, of course, have a funeral service as well, okay? Their obsession with women and our lady parts is the stuff of legend, but outside of regulating a woman's right to choice, they tend to have very little concern with actually improving the lives of women and girls. None, as a matter of fact. I could care less. So if it shouldn't come as any surprise, then, that while the state claims to be on the forefront of combating sex trafficking, they have spent more money on catching pimps than working on to rehab the victims of trafficking. There you go. Devoted hardly any resources to the victims whose testimony is essential to putting sex traffickers behind bars. They have also failed to confront the role of the child welfare system plays in providing a supply of vulnerable kids to criminals waiting to exploit them. 86% of missing children suspected of being forced into sex work came from the child welfare system, national data show. And a state-funded study estimated that the vast majority of young victims in Texas had some contact with child protective services. So there you go. It would seem to me that'd be the easiest way to do it if you were a sex trafficker. So, you know, could I possibly take a look at your records here and see who, you know, who the latest clients you got going are? Oh, okay, I see. Susie, okay, she lives over on Flower Avenue. Yeah, okay, well, we'll be picking her ass up here tomorrow. Thank you. Yeah. So there it is. The records are right there. You just got to find the records, and they're probably online. Probably, you know. So, I mean, I'm sure it's not that difficult for some sex trafficker to look up who's who and what's what, where they live and yada yada, where they go to school, and, you know, we'll pick that little 6-year-old up before she knows it. Yeah. Apparently, the state has lots of use for you if you can testify against the person who has forced you into sex work and help them get a conviction. They made it easier to prosecute men and women who exploit minors, as well as the buyers who seek to purchase sex with them. They've established a special team inside the Attorney General's office to help unravel sex trafficking rings. But reforming the foster care system or paying for victim services? No, we're not going to do that. The victim can go straight to hell. We don't care. Not gonna happen. We'll prosecute the perps, but we're not going to take care of the victims. Hell with that. Can't be bothered. Besides that, it costs money. We can make money, thank you, by sending these perps to our own prisons. Thank you very much. We own the prison just around the corner there, so, you know, we sent them there. It's all about filling up the beds there. Let's see. 2015 law allowing police to take emergency possession of sex trafficking victims as long as they place them in secure facilities, providing everything from 24-hour supervision to counseling. But no such facility exists, and no funding has ever been allocated to create such a emergency possession thingy. Okay, so it's not going to get done. Isn't there a saying that insanity is doing the same thing over and over again but expecting different results? Establishing laws to fund programs that help trafficking victims but not allocating the funds is madness. Catching predators who traffic girls into sex work is critically important, but doing it at the expense of helping the victim feels like very small progress towards protecting them. Yeah, there's no effort to protect, that's for sure. It's also worth noting that during this year's Super Bowl in Houston, 183 would-be sex buyers and 9 sex traffickers were arrested. That's a pretty good start, but it isn't enough. Hey, Texas, if your lawmakers can put so much time, money, and effort into protecting the unborn, how about doing the same for the girls after they've been born? Damn it. Not a chance. Not a chance of that happening. It costs money. If it costs money, we're not going to do it. $183 would-be sex buyers at the Super Bowl. Yeah, I guess, yeah. I guess why not? I guess you're gonna, yeah, I guess that's what you go there for. I don't know. I mean, I thought, you know, you'd think everybody goes to Vegas for that, but I guess they just go, you know, go anywhere, I guess. Where are you? What happened here? Okay. Well, that was Kelly Macias, by the way, on the front page. The sex trafficking. I don't know how you. I got to figure out how you pronounce that name sometime. Yeah. Nevertheless, she persisted, is the feminist rallying cry of 2017. Yeah, I kind of like that myself. We'll get to that in a little bit. I don't know who that Congress critter or senator is there, but, I don't know. Okay, I'll figure it out later on, too. Paul Ryan makes promise to Trump he can't keep as Republican infighting on Obamacare deepens. It's by Joan McCarter on the front page. And Paul Ryan, of course, looking at 2020. He's one of the guys from 2020. So, yeah, he's going to try to do what he can do to stir that up and keep his name out there and, you know, make sure that... You know, so it's important in 2020 to just pound these freaking asshats, really. Pound them. You know, 2018, we got to get towards, moving towards taking back the House. And in 2020, we need to take back the House. There's no question about it. So we got two times to get that done. And we might be able to flip. I don't think we're going to flip it this year in New York 21, but we'll probably flip it in 2020. I think we're going to flip it in 2020 because we got a pretty good young kid that's running, and he's just got to get his name out this time for 2018. Just got to get the name out there so that when he comes around again in 2020, oh, yeah, I remember that kid. Yeah, I'm going to vote for him this time, damn, but screw that Beltway Elise. I'm tired of her crap. So, you know, we might get luckier in 2020 and New York 21 and gain a seat back that we had there in 2010. We won a few seats, I think, in 2010 to push back the tsunami that was the Tea Party. We hung on to that seat, but not for very long, unfortunately. Well, this is a bit of a problem for House Speaker Paul Ryan, and I hope we continue to get a lot more problems for Paul Ryan between now and 2018, 2020. After bills signing, Trump turned to Ryan and asked about Obamacare repeal bill. It's going to be very soon, right, Ryan? Yeah. It's going to be very soon. Maybe never. Trump's yes man has a very serious problem here in making those kinds of promises. That's because Republicans now are all out warfare over how they're going to do the repeal. Not replace, mind you, just repeal it. Forget the replace part. Just stop on that damn Obamacare and light a match to it. They haven't gotten that far. They're still stuck on the one part they all agree on, repeal. They have no plan to replace whatsoever. And, of course, that's always, you know, that's been the thing for the last 6 years or whatever. Yeah, 6 years or so. That they've never had any intention to replace it. It's always been about repeal, repeal, repeal. Because, you know, because it's so liberal. Because it was written by the Heritage Foundation. You know, a liberal bunch like that writing a you know, a healthcare program. And you go, holy cow, man, we can't have any liberal something like that. Heritage Foundation, jabers. About as right-wing as it gets, the Heritage Foundation, all right? You're just to the, barely to the left of Hitler right there, okay? I might as well mention him right now, yeah. Yeah, I mean they're there, they're close. Heritage Foundation, you know, when you figure you're writing that thing, why not? Mine is just loaded up with all kinds of right-wing stuff. And Obamacare is all about, it was basically taken page for page right from that, right from what they wrote down there. What they proposed back in, 2006 or so. Same thing, same plan. So Obama didn't really change much to that thing, just the way it worked. Okay. Got to do this real quick. Maybe not. Oh, there we go. Okay. Moment yourselves. Okay. Okay. Get this chat thing opened up. Forgot to do that. There you go. Yeah, you can get to the chat now. Okay. Finally in there. If you got something, that's the best way to do it. If you want to get on the radio without actually getting on the radio, just go to the chat and bang something. I'll get it on for you. That's what we got that. Pretty much that's why we got that there for. And then you can hang out there and just throw spitballs or whatever the hell you want to do. It's a good spot to hang out. And the easiest way to get there is our homepage. Just go to netroots.radio.com and just scroll all the way down to the bottom. You'll see it on the right-hand side of the page. Click that, and that's how you get into chat. Well, I mean, you got to scroll down. Once the page opens, you got to scroll down a little bit, but about it. Pretty simple. As simple as we can make it, anyway, at this point. But yeah, Paul Ryan. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. The more centrist wing of the party wants to slow the entire process down. They say Republicans need to act deliberately to avoid public panic over millions potentially losing their insurance. The party, they agree, needs to put forward a replacement plan before it ditches the law. Forget the 2015 repeal bill that Barack Obama vetoed. They had. It's not relevant now that Republicans own the problem. You do own it. If you want to work on it, it's yours. It's not realistic, says Senator Jeff Flake of Arizona. The 2015 bill, the imperative is to do it right, and I don't think that does it right. I don't think you'll find much currency for that approach in the Senate, so it's going to take a while. So it's nice to see that at least some in the Republican Party are kind of going, hey, wait a second. There we go. Joel McCarthy on the front page, net neutrality, the one we love to wrap our arms around. The only thing that's saving our ass is net neutrality, okay? For those that spend any time at all on the intertubes, net neutrality is the only thing saving our ass. Otherwise, forget about it. We wouldn't even be able to get on, most of us. Net neutrality foe, John Thune, starts work on legislation to fuck it. Let's be clear here. He just wants to tear that thing right apart. Okay. Thune has evil plans for the internet and maybe Mitch McConnell. Okay. Senator John Thune, doesn't want to wait around for the new FCC to kill net neutrality. Or perhaps it's that as big telecom overlords don't want to wait. So he's moving forward with trying to craft legislation. The new FCC. Well, I guess with the Republicans in charge, we do have a new FCC that will just kill it anyway. So I don't know why. That's not going to take long. Can't possibly take it. It's going to be less than 6 months. So I don't know what the big hurry is. Except they want their money now. Okay, that's what it's about. That's the only thing really it's about is they want their money now. They don't want to wait 6 months. Oh, okay. You want the faster version of the internet? Okay, that'll cost you about $99 a month. Okay, no problem. Yeah, and we guarantee 89-90% uptime. You're not going to get much downtime. We squeeze you a bit now and then, but it's only about 10% of the time. Usually during prime time, from like noon to midnight. Prime time, you get squeezed a bit, but after midnight to noon, you're good. You're pretty good there. If you're a night owl, you're going to love the internet because you'll be able to zoom right through it. If you're using it for work, forget about it. You're going to be squeezed. Sorry about that, but, what do you want for $99 a month? So yeah, there you go. That's what you're going to be looking like here pretty quickly. Senator Thune is open to immediately working with his colleagues on legislation if there is a serious readiness on the other side of the aisle to come to the table. Why would there be? Commerce Committee spokesman Frederick Hill said Friday in an email to someplace, to date, Democrats haven't been quite ready to sit down. Well, hopefully not. If they, you know, if they consider themselves a Democrat, I hope they keep, you know, just standing up. At the same time, Hill added that action from the FCC action could lead to new engagement from Democrats in a legislative effort. And Thune is all for that. Many Senate Democrats have been steadfast in the desire to preserve the net neutrality rules and the enforcement power given to the FCC. But with little leverage in Congress and at the agency, those senators have said constituents should flood lawmakers' offices with calls and the FCC with comments to voice their support for the open internet order. Well, you know, that should be a closed deal. You know, this has been going on for 10 years, this freaking net neutrality crap. And, you know, the net neutrality side has won. And after a while, you got to say, okay, you guys have made your case. Shut up and sit down. Get the hell out of here, okay? And net neutrality lives for the day, and it's going to live for the next 100 years. So take your case and take it and then shove it where the sun don't shine. But no, they'll just keep coming back with legislation that says, okay, we're going to eliminate that all that nonsense, and we'll start charging you $99 a month pretty quickly here. And also throttling down when you're, you know, taking care of business. Don't worry about it. Your internet will be about as slow as a friggin' dial-up service back in the day. Anybody had dial-up? And if you remember dial-up, it'd be slow as that, and it'd be charged about five times what you're paying now for, broadband, essentially. And I don't even call this broadband, but it's what they consider broadband here. So anyway, you're gonna. Thune wants to pretend like he's supporting net neutrality by pushing legislation that would codify certain principles that base the idea of net neutrality into law, such as the prohibition of paid prioritization and blocking and throttling online content, but he would stop short of the open internet order that's still, in effect, essentially classifying broadband as a utility and giving the FCC the power to actually enforce the rules. So they'll get rid of that part of it. But in fact, the internet is a utility, okay? It's just like your electricity bill, okay? Same as electricity, same as if you got natural gas coming into your house, same as that. It's a utility. Republicans and the powers of be, you know, the oligarch looks at it like, oh, gee, that's ours. What are you talking about? Utility, that's ours. We built that. Senate Democrats are absolutely right. They can refuse to work with Thune, and they can filibuster bad legislation, but they need us. They need the millions of people to make phone calls and write letters and blah, 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 blah. And, yeah. I mean, that's what, you know, we've been doing that for last, like I said, we've been doing that for the last 10 years, just hoping that, you know, this would still, what they did was make it a utility, and therefore, you know, blah, 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 blah. You cannot, you have to go through a process to, like the electric companies do, to raise rates and blah, 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 blah. You just can't do that willy-nilly just because you own, you know, part of the business. You can't just go, oh, wait a second, we're going to jack that up another 10, 15 bucks. Let's give FCC Chairman Ashi Pai and the FCC a reminder of what getting 6 million comments on an issue is like. Call or write the FCC and tell them they can't sneak our open internet away. I encourage that as well. I mean, that's something, if you don't do anything this year at all, besides, you know, any activism at all this year at all, do this one thing. Call your Congress critter or send an email or whatever, and make your case that you are one of the millions of people that want this thing to be an open internet and make it a utility like it's been for the last, I don't know, 10 years. That's probably the best activism you can display this year in 2017 is to do that, just to make keeping the internet open. So the power, you know, the people that think they own it can throttle it down, can make sure you don't see certain sites without paying a premium. Oh, you want to go to Daily Coast? Oh, yeah, well, you're going to pay a premium for that. That's one of those libtard sites. Yeah, you'll be paying an extra $10 a month for that. Because that's exactly what they want to do with it. They want to piecemeal the internet. Make it look like, oh, you want to subscribe to that site? Great, that'll be $5 a month. You want to subscribe to that one? Oh, that'll be $12 a month. It'll be just like having a bunch of magazines, you know, subscribing to a bunch of magazines just so you can go to a webpage. So that's what they consider it, basically. Information, you know, it's their information, damn it. They own it, so we're going to charge you for it. You want to see it? You're going to have to pay for it. Take that, you liberal sons of bitches. Try to do OWS out of that. And your freaking other crap you're doing out there, you sons of bitches. We got your Indivisible right here, damn it. Oh, you wanna play Indivisible? Yeah, it's gonna cost you $50 a month. On top of whatever your else are paying, you know, blah blah blah. Yeah. We see you typing that Indivisible down there. Okay, that's gonna cost you money. Yeah, so do that. Make a call or email or whatever you gotta do. I'm gonna send about 50 freaking emails out there. Trump carried this Minnesota seat by 29 points, but the GOP won it by just 6 in a special election. Sadly, they won it, though. That's a big thing right there. I don't care if they won by 1, they won. So a funny thing happened on Tuesday night in Minnesota, which held a special, you know, in Minnesota, Wisconsin. You know, they try their best out there, but they lose to the Republicans every freaking time. Funny thing happened on Tuesday night in Minnesota, which held a special election for a vacant seat in the state house there, which is the state, not the federal, you know, not the Capitol Hill, but the state house, which is their legislative offices, etc., etc. The district, known as 32B and located in the Minneapolis exurbs, whatever the hell they are, voted for Donald Trump by an overwhelming 61-32 margin. But Republican and New beat Democrat Lori Wagner just 53-47. Put it another way, the GOP did 23 points worse on Tuesday than Trump did in November. And it's hard to see how that's a positive sign for them. Well, maybe not, but they won. Now, a win's still a win. And yeah, we lost, but this isn't about moral victories or narratives or anything so gossamer. Rather, the results are interesting because they have us wondering whether we'll see this kind of turn against Trump in other districts in the near future. Well, I don't know. You got to look for 2018 for that, because these little runoff elections and blah, 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 you get 5 or 6 of them a year. That, you know, you got this open seat here and you got this open seat there, whatever, blah, blah, blah. They don't really tell you which direction the wind is blowing, let's put it that way. Needless to say, if a seat that Trump won by, say, 10 points were to also shift against Republicans by 23 points, they'd be screwed. Maybe. This, though, is where the cautious analysis steps in, notes that it's just a single data point, and it may not mean much. Yeah, there you go. Exactly right, as I was saying. Where the cautious analyst steps in, notes that this is just a single data point, and it may not mean much. Exactly right. But as it happens, we actually have more than one data point we can look at. And so far, since Trump's Electoral College win on November 8th, there have been 5 legislative special elections around the country that have featured candidates from both major parties on the ballot. 2 in Iowa, 2 in Virginia, and 1 in Minnesota. My cousin lived out there in Minnesota, and I just liked the way she said it. Can't say it the way she did it, but I can't, you know, I try to make it, but, and she, you know, she's born and raised here near 21, so there you go. Met a doctor, moved out there, blah, 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 and, you know, the rest, as they say, is history, but, man, she could say Minnesota really well, just get me every time. In 4 of those races, Democrats ran ahead of the 2016 presidential margin. by double digits in three of those. This is still a small sample size, but you'd rather be the party beating your benchmarks than the one falling behind them. Yeah, I guess. The thing is, though, you got to do it again next year. You know, I mean, this, you know, to me, it's like baseball. It's like some guy coming to bat. You know, he's okay, this is Joe Blow coming to bat. He is 0 for his last 21. He hasn't hit dick in a week. Okay, he's 0 for 21. He hasn't hit dick all week. Okay, but it's a new at bat that he's batting 0-0-0. And he's either going to go back to the bench batting 0-0-0, or he's going to be batting 1,000. So, I mean, it really, you know, the fact that he's 0 for his last 21 really doesn't mean a damn thing. This is a brand new at bat. Every brand new at bat is a new at bat. What he did last, you know, last 10 or last 20 or last 30 at bats really don't amount to jack. He could be hitting a million. Boom, you know, that's the way it works. You know, he could be hitting like, 800 over the last month or so, and then come back and one day have 3 strikeouts back to back to back. So those figures, those numbers don't mean a whole lot. Yeah, that's what I like about baseball, because it doesn't really, oh yeah, Joe Blow is hitting, he's 0 for his last 20. Well, it doesn't make any difference, because this could be a home run. This at bat could be a home run, or it could be just a base hit. Just get him, you know, get him going again. It doesn't, the 0 for 21 does not reflect on much of anything. Maybe that's the wrong one. Okay, no, it ain't. Okay, it's a keyboard. Okay. Oh, there we go. Okay. I mean, yeah, like I said, those numbers don't mean nothing, because 2018 is still a year and a half away. You know, so I mean, we could win them all between now and then. Once it comes to November 2018, then let me know how well we did. Okay, because that's the only numbers that matter. Rand Paul sees no reason for Flynn probe. Of course, none of the Republicans see no reason for the Flynn probe. And of course, Al Rushmore. I was listening to Al Rushmore today. You know, 10 minutes here, 20 minutes, you know, not even 20 minutes, 10 minutes stretches at a time, generally speaking. 10 minutes here, 10 minutes there, whatever. And that's all he was talking about. Is, you know, this Flynn probe was a bunch of nonsense, nothing to it. It's all those liberal bastards trying to get to Trump, you know, through his cabinet. They're going to dismantle the cabinet, and then they're going to dismantle Trump. And I said, yeah, you're damn right we are. That's exactly what we're going to do. Well, they luck it off. The Democrats are smart anyway. Add Senator Rand Paul to the list of Republicans who don't see any reason at all they want to investigate what now resigned Trump advisor Michael Flynn discussed with Russia. His reason is particularly blunt. I just don't think it's useful to be doing investigation after investigation after investigation like we did with Hillary. Okay? Like we did with Hillary. Remember that? Investigation after investigation after fucking investigation. I don't see any, you know, there's no use doing these investigations, particularly of your own party, he said. Well, we'll never even get started with doing the things we need to do, like repealing Obamacare, if we're spending our whole friggin' time investigating Republicans. I think it makes no sense. Unless, of course, a crime might have been committed. Yeah, let's just investigate Hillary some more while she's, you know, while we got her face in the mud and our boot to her head, face in the mud. We'll just go investigate more of her. Let's go do that. Indeed, investigating wrongdoing by fellow Republicans would be so divisive, so distracting. Maybe people have been breaking laws, maybe not. But what's truly important here is that the party remained protected. Damn it. Party over country. Remember that? That's how it goes, right? Yep, exactly right. Rand Paul had and probably still has dreams of being president of the United States. He was supposed to be one of the serious Republican pundits. Serious Republicans and pundits like to drone on about the ones who might at some point in some small way do the right thing if, you know, really back them into a corner on it. No, not so much, because it just turns out that he's just a hack. Now he's hacking what? He's got some sort of freaking product he's hacking on the radio airwaves. I noticed listening to El Rushbo, now and then, that he's on there hacking some for you. Remember me, I'm Rand Paul. I ran for president. Hello? Is this mic on? Hello? Do you remember me? I'm Rand Paul. I ran for president back. Well, now I'm hacking a product here. And you need to buy this product, damn it, because I'm Rand Paul. Take that, you liberal sons of bitches. I'll get you next time. I guess. I think he should be done. I think when he gets slammed like he got slammed in 2015, 2016, I think you just walk away and say, okay, we tried that. Not going to do that again. There's no sense doing that again because I got my freaking butt kicked. But no, he's going to be back out there because there's nobody else, I guess. And so is the Florida senator. What the hell is his name? Rubio? Rubio will be back out there. If you can imagine that. And the sad thing is, we probably got nobody to counter that nonsense. Don't get me started. Apparently, grabbing women by their lady parts is common practice in state legislatures. I don't know. I can't think of any, but okay. This is by Kelly Messias on the front page. Sex offenders work in the White House and also in state legislatures. Well, yeah, there is something to that because... once you get elected to even a statewide position, like just in your assembly or whatever, your state assembly or your state senate, whatever the hell it happens to be. Here we got the senate, the assembly, and the senate. The assembly is like the House of Representatives. Comes up every 2 years for re-election, and the senate, just like the U.S. Senate, it comes up every 6. But once you even in a lowly assembly, a state assembly, where you're just a yahoo that barely recognizable as a public official or a public whatever representative, you still carry that around. I'm hey, wait a second here. I'm something. I'm elected to office right here in Albany, New York. You bet your sweet bippy. And if I want to grab lady parts, I'll grab myself some lady parts. Take that, you liberal bastards. So I think there is that kind of, you're walking around like a rock star or something, or you just go up there and grab some breasts or something. I don't know. I guess there's that part of it too. Women generally know that there are very few places where we are safe in public. Yeah, sadly, just leaving our homes makes us targets for sexual harassment, and our work lives are no exception. In the old boys club known as politics, where women are grossly underrepresented in positions of power, we are particularly at risk. Particularly, if I can, get that out of there. I don't think I can. And recent incidents with lawmakers who can't seem to stop themselves from preying on the women they work with shows we have good reason to worry. I just find that, if you were in a regular workplace, you'd be freaking canned in a heartbeat. Your ass would be out the door. You grab somebody's butt or their lady parts or their breasts or boobs or whatever. Gone. Done. You're done. But on Capitol Hill or in the state houses, you can get away with this stuff, I guess. Apparently. Sexual harassment isn't uncommon in state legislatures, although the number of complaints has never been compiled. Men hold on average more than 75% of seats, along with most of the positions of power, while women compose a high percentage of staff members, office employees, interns, and lobbyists. Yeah, well, you got that going on. I mean, when you got some college kid in there as your intern, I'm gonna make a move on that, I guess. because you can, I guess, sweetheart, you want to come over here for just a second? I just want to grab your ass. Okay, thank you. In the last month, legislators in Oklahoma and South Dakota have resigned after complaints of sexual harassment. Wow, that's a big deal right there. I mean, to get these guys to resign from a little ass grabbing, literally ass grabbing, That's something else. Another inappropriate contact with female employees. Like I said, in any other work situation, you'd be out the door anyway. I mean, it's not like it's not appropriate behavior. It's not acceptable behavior by any means. But you just kind of expect that the legislators today would get away with this crap. But I guess in this case they did not. That's a good sign. That's a great sign. So it is happening at least. Legislators in Oklahoma and South Dakota have resigned after complaints of sexual harassment and other inappropriate contact with female employees. Last year, one lawmaker in Tennessee was expelled after having reportedly made advancements toward more than 20 women. And in recent years, there have been sex scandals in at least 8 other state houses. And those are only the ones which are documented. Yet there are a few procedures to place or to address sexual harassment and to keep women safe in state legislatures. Yeah, well, yeah. I mean, number one, because it's always been an old boys club. And it's kind of one of the things you look the other way. As one of your colleagues is grabbing somebody's ass, you kind of just look the other way. Nope, didn't see that. but now it's becoming more of a bigger deal, which is great. Like I say, if that happened in any kind of workplace, you'd be toast. You'd be out of there in about 10 seconds. Gone. Grab your freaking stuff off your desk. You're out of here. So now that it's happening in the legislatures, that's pretty good. Because like I say, most of those guys parade around, prance around like they're Mick Jagger, you know, a rock star, where, you know, Mick can get away with that stuff, but he's Mick, and you're not. You think you are, but you're not. Despite persistent incidents, many legislatures lack formal procedures for dealing with sexual harassment. While corporate America, colleges, and government agencies have established procedures or processes for investigating complaints, state legislatures remain an often murky domain in which top leaders have broad latitude over how or whether to pursue allegations and can sidetrack them if they choose. Yeah, exactly right. And often do sidetrack them, okay? It's not that they can, it's that they do sidetrack them. State legislatures are an ideal environment for covering up sexual improprieties, so women are reluctant to report incidents, said Maya Ragu, a Washington, D.C. attorney specializing in women's issues who has conducted research on workplace sexual harassment. No question that. If you want to harass women, get elected to your state house. Then you can just grab as much ass as you want. I mean, right out there in broad daylight in front of God and everybody, just grab a handful. That's about the only place you're going to be able to get away with that crap. And thankfully, and it looks like that's also coming to an end. At least an attempt is being made here to say, hey, wait a second, this is BS. Your ass is out of here. Resign tomorrow. Get out of here. So that's, good for that to happen, because it's been 100, at least 100 years, 200 years, whatever, in this case, the U.S. of A, that, if you're in the state house or even in the Capitol Hill, you can get away with this crap just because you are the rock star. And the little missus is just a little missus, and she's not going to say anything. I'll take that. Yeah, I had that going way back. My GF that used to work at a restaurant, kind of like what's that wings and beer place? I can't think of these freaking names because I never go to these restaurants. But there's a chain restaurant that serves wings and beer. It's coming to. Yeah, they got the short shorts and the loose tops kind of thing. And anyway, she didn't work at that place, but she worked at a restaurant kind of similar to that, only they didn't dress so, they dressed more appropriately for the restaurant they were working at. It was more of a family restaurant. It wasn't a place where the college kids were going to come in and grab some beers and some wings and some ass, if they could grab that. Because I think in that particular restaurant, I think you get a Hooters. That's something. Hooters. I'm not trying to trash Hooters, but You could probably get away with a little ass grabbing at Hooters. Maybe not. I don't know. But anyway, this was, she worked at a place like that, only more family oriented and more dressed appropriately. But their boss always, they said, well, you got to wear a bra. You got to wear a bra. And she was like a, 32A, 32B. She didn't need to wear a bra. She didn't need a bra. you look good in a t-shirt, you don't need a bra, so blah, blah, blah. But your boss kind of took a close note and said, no, I don't think she's wearing a bra. So he opened up, pulled her shirt away from her neckline and just looked down and said, you're supposed to be wearing a bra. And he'd pull that about every 4 or 5 days. What a freaking moron. I said, she's small, leave her alone. She don't need no bra, for crying out loud. Jeez. Give it a rest. But yeah, he would just pull that stunt just to harass, just sexual harassment. That's all it was, just to show that hey, I'm the boss and you aren't, And by the way, put a bra on, damn it. And trust me, nobody would have known she's not wearing a bra because didn't matter whether she was wearing one or not. She didn't need one. Here's something Rouse Speaker Paul Ryan to chew on as he battles futilely to unite Republicans behind the Obamacare repeal and replace plan. Obamacare is doing pretty well at the moment. Thank you very much. Joe McCarter on the front page. Chew on this, Paul Ryan. Nation's uninsured rate is at an all-time low. And yeah, that's not a bad thing, except that you still got to somehow pay for this insurance that you go to the, when you go to the doctor, you're going to still end up paying for it. About it. I mean, your Obamacare pays very little of it, unfortunately. I wish it was different, but. The uninsured rate remains at a record low, according to brand new data from the CDC. In the first 9 months of 2016, 28 million or less than 9% of adults were uninsured. More than 20 million fewer persons than in 2010. Yeah, if this thing was such a great insurance plan, you would have thought those 40 million or 30 million or how many millions of people were uninsured would have been signed up the first year. Shouldn't take freaking 6 years, 7 years, 8 years, whatever it's been, to get everybody, and we're still short of the 20 million or whatever it is. It's just one of those things. It's just a bad deal for the most part. Barbara Murillo on the front page. White House says Trump has been incredibly tough on Russia. Trump disagrees with that. And I guess Vlad says the Trumpster owes him something, and if he has to, he can come get it. I mean, he's got the wherewithal all the stuff he needs to come collect the debt. While we wait for the next bombshell revelation about the popular vote losers' ties to Russia, and for congressional Republicans to put country over party, let's take a moment to revisit a laughable moment from Tuesday's White House press briefing by none other than Sean Spicer, where he said, "The irony of this entire situation is that the president has been incredibly tough on Russia, you liberal bastards, so take that." Yeah. Yeah, meanwhile, Vlad leans back and lights up a cigarette. Yeah, oh yeah, no question. Vlad has got the Donald right by the Yale Shore ones, no question. Hunter on the front page. Senators McCaskill, Carper asked Defense Department to clarify Trump's use of unsecured smartphone. I don't need a secured smartphone, damn it, I am the Donald. Okay, let's make that clear. We keep hearing that Donald is continuing to use his original unsecured Android smartphone. I don't know, why the hell would he use an Android smartphone when he, I don't get it. Well, in the White House, now Democratic Senators Claire McCaskill and Tom Carper have written a letter to Secretary of Defense Jim Mattis asking him to explain what the hell is up with that. Exactly. McCaskill and Carper say that the recent report suggesting that the president may still be using his old device were troubling, and in part because it doesn't leave a record of what he's been saying. While it is important for the president to have the ability to communicate electronically, it is equally important that he does so in a manner that is secure, that ensures the preservation of presidential records. There you go. Exactly right. If for no other reason than that. The even more obvious problem with using the unsecured phone is, of course, security. Images of Trump staffers holding up smartphones to examine documents about a North Korea missile launch immediately caused consternation among those who wondered whether holding up devices with attached digital cameras and pointing them directly at presumably sensitive paperwork was, well, stupid. With the ease with which unsecured phones can be hacked by competent non-state hackers, if Donald Trump is walking around the Oval Office with an unsecured phone on his desk, it's essentially acting as a microphone. The White House might not be keeping track of Trump's conversations, but somebody else might be, and it might be one of Putin's friends, more than likely. Quick break, liquid refreshment break here, and we'll be back in a minute. Damn it, I didn't get that one booted up either. I'll get it for next time. I gotta look for that. I think I still have to edit it too. Okay, but we'll come up. We'll do something. Okay. Back in about 2 minutes. Back. We'll be right back. Okay, we'll get one of these buttons right. There we go. Okay. 417-777-1454. Try to do that. That's how we get on. Let me get this up just to Kitty Whisker. I did figure out who that guitar player was. I forgot the guy's name, but I know who he is. Played on Peter Gabriel's first tour, which is pretty good, and then, in 1977. Excellent guitar player. And then Sidney McGinnis played the second tour, I believe. Sidney McGinnis played the second tour of Peter Gabriel. And then Sidney McGinnis went to the Late Show with David Letterman with Paul Schaefer's band. But also, Sid McGinnis, also a great guitar player. And you're that good a guitar player and you're playing for a band like on the Late Show. It just seems weird when you can play. You know, you're basically a gunslinger. You can play for any damn band that needs a guitar player. You know, for on a tour, say. And you can go from year to year to year doing it easily. And I don't know, maybe you don't make the same money you would on a Late Show, but holy cow, I think it would be more fun to play with these bands. Though Paul Schaefer Band was an excellent band. Great drummer. Everybody else is pretty good, too. But Sidney McGinnis, just a great guitar player as well. Way underrated. Where are we here? Let me get this. I don't know. It's just a Kitty Whisker. Okay, that'll work, I guess. I don't know. I guess I gotta get that up a little bit. There we go. Try that. Okay. All right. That'll work. Yeah, but Sidney McGinnis with the David Letterman band with Paul Schaefer. Yeah, pretty good guitar player. But he did, I'm pretty sure he played the second tour with Peter Gabriel back in the day. It would be 78. And I was lucky enough to catch that show in a gymnasium. For real, yeah, basketball court, gymnasium. Peter Gabriel played in one of those. How about that? In 1978, in the college campus here. I go, man, you got to be freaking kidding me. He's playing in a gymnasium. Does anybody know who Peter Gabriel is, for credit? But yeah, they stuffed about 1,500 people in there, I guess. So he sold about 1,500 tickets. Somehow, I don't know how they did it, but way in the back. I'm way in the back by the basketball courts and. It was a memorable show. It was a great show, number one. But the thing about that show was he opened for himself. I think I probably told the story before, but he opened for himself in 1978, at least here at this, in the gymnasium. Everybody booing, everybody booing, boo, boo, Gabriel, Gabriel, Gabriel from the audience. And then he comes out by himself and a teddy bear. He's got a teddy bear with him. And he sings, me and my teddy bear, that whole friggin' thing, whatever the hell that is. And I can't sing for crap, but so he does that. And they boo, they boo his ass. And he's this particular tour, he was bald. He had no hair. So that was the reference to me and my teddy bear, had no hair, blah, 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 whatever that song is. Can't remember how it goes. But he did that. He did that whole song, 2 minutes of that or whatever, and they're throwing tomatoes at him. Not quite, but boo, trying to boo this guy off the stage. Who the hell is this guy? And I'm going from way back in the distance. I can, he's a million miles away. Even in a gymnasium, it just seemed like it's forever away. But I could hear the voice. I said, oh, that's Peter Gabriel. I didn't know that he was bald, for this particular tour. He had no hair, but I said, oh my God, that's Peter Gabriel opening for himself. And nobody here knows it. None of the crowd knows it, or very few knew it, and then he goes off the stage, and then they come back, and they came out the back of the gymnasium, which is right close to us. They're going through a side door, the whole band, and there's one guy the only guy on stage is the drummer, and he's I think he's trying to, he's doing the Biko drumming, I think is what he's doing. Anyway, he's drumming away, and the rest of them coming through with flashlights that are kind of like floodlights. And the auditorium's dark anyway, you know, obviously. And they got these flashlights, and they're just flashing them around the crowd as they're kind of moving from the back of the crowd to the stage. And they're going real slow, taking their time, and just shaking hands, saying hello to people. And just moving their way. And I said, man, this is the greatest entrance ever, I think. This is, you know, this is this freaking outstanding entrance for a band to get from, you know, instead of just walking on the stage and playing, they're coming from the back of the auditorium and making their way to the stage through the crowd, and everybody's freaking going ballistic, just cheering away, and just a great entrance. That's my story on that tour. But Sidney McGuinness played on that tour. Oh my God, going way back. And I'm a long time Gabriel fan, that's all. Let's see, get this where it's belongs. That's belongs there. Boom. Yeah, okay, well, I guess we're good. Let's see if I can get back here to the GOS. Maybe. Maybe not. Oh, there we go. Okay, there we go. Got back. Okay. Navigation. I'm hoping they go back to DK4 for navigation purposes. They just can't find my way along. This whole freaking DK5. Maryland lawmakers passed resolution allowing Attorney General to file suit against Trump's policies. What the hell are you talking about? That's going a little bit over the top, I think. Oh, no, let's do this. It's Kelly Macias. Let's go with this story here. They've been waiting for 44 years to overturn Roe v. Wade, and now they have their chance. Yeah, I agree, they do. Yeah, looks like the right wing will overturn Roe v. Wade. Mostly because nobody has stopped this over the last 15 years. Certainly since George W., you know, took over in 2001. The right wing has been, you know, trying to chip away at this Roe v. Wade thing. And they pretty much watered it down to nothing anyway. There's only about 10 states in the country that allow abortion on the way it was intended back in 1973, that's for sure. About 10 states. The other 40, you know, you're going to have to, wait a second here. You got to fill this out. You got to fill that out. Yeah, and by the way, you got to have a funeral service for the remains and, a burial. Yeah. You want to have an abortion? Take that. How many times do women have to tell Republicans to stay out of our uteruses? I would say, if you don't continue to do it, they will continue to hack away. Let's put it that way. And they've just about, whittled this thing down to nothing. So, I mean, it's either now or never for the Democrats to step up, the liberals to step up, the progressives to step up and say, wait a second, this is enough of this nonsense. We're going to continue to have Roe v. Wade. Fuck you. But you got to start it now. I mean, they're going to do this. They're going to get it done. Roe v. Wade will be swept under the rug, and you'll never see that probably again. Here we are, less than a month into Donald Trump's presidency, and he has his merry band of misfits are busy actively working to dismantle our rights and our democracy. And if they get their way and finally control women's bodies the way they want to, there will be several states that take the lead in banning abortion. Yeah, no question. Most of them are there already. I mean, there's only a couple of things they got to do to make that happen. Apparently, 10 states across the country have just been itching since 73 to have their say again on a woman's uterus, hoping for a Supreme Court reversal on Roe v. Wade. And under Trump, they may actually get their chance. And, I used to be a Roe v. Wade voter. You know, if somebody wasn't a Roe v. Wade supporter, I would not vote for them. I don't care which party they belong to. If they were a Roe v. Wade supporter, I would vote for them. That's how I voted often. That was my issue. Are you one of those single issue voters? Yep, I am. Because Roe v. Wade is pretty much the cornerstone of any 60s gains we made toward any kind of liberal policies involved, and Roe v. Wade is at heart and center of it, no question. You take away Roe v. Wade, you might as well dismantle the entire 60s gains made on any kind of public policy. It's just, you know, gone. I'm a single issue voter, and when it comes to, you know, that kind of thing, Roe v. Wade, if they're not for Roe v. Wade, I will not vote for their ass. I don't care who they are. Apparently, 10 states across the country have just been itching since 1973 to have their say again on a woman's uterus, hoping for a Supreme Court reversal on Roe v. Wade. And under Trump, they might get their wish. They are often referred to as trigger laws, because even though each state's provision works a bit differently, the measures are triggered by the reversal of Roe v. Wade. Should that occur, these states commit to making abortion illegal in all cases except to protect a mother's life, just as it was before the Supreme Court's 1973 ruling. In four states, the trigger law makes the switch back to illegal abortion automatic. There you go. Boom. And, of course, like I say, these women, these liberal, quote-unquote liberal women, have been missing the boat on this for 15 fucking years. I don't know where they've been. I don't know if they've got, you know, they got their head in the sand or what, but they have not been out there trying to stop any of this stuff. And if they don't want to go out there and stop it, well, guess what? Nobody else is going to do it either. So, I mean, you know, they just refuse to do the heavy lifting, as they say. This stuff has to be done. Sorry, you got to go to work on this stuff. It just doesn't take care of itself. There's work involved. Remember when Trump promised to appoint Supreme Court justices that would overturn the court's ruling that abortion is a constitutionally protected right? Yeah, that seemed pretty outrageous when he was a candidate, but now he's president. He's not so far-fetched, and that's not all. Many of the trigger laws not only impact a woman's right to an abortion, but can also limit her access to birth control. So take that. Try to get birth control, you bitches. Try that, you sons of bitches. Yeah. Yeah, here we are. We're just kind of, oh, yeah, well, we got Roe v. Wade protecting our ass. Oh, yeah. Yeah, where you been the last 15 years? Not paying attention, no question about that. Many such laws, including the one in Illinois, go even further, saying that if Roe is overturned, the state intends to renew their so-called policy that life begins at conception. This approach could not only affect the legality of abortion, but also common forms of birth control, such as Plan B or IUDs, which some anti-abortion advocates consider to be abortificants. Despite medical consensus to the contrary, they are not abortificants, you bastards, but they will get their way, because nobody's going to push them back and say, no, 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 no. And the courts, you know, well, we know what the courts look like, so take that. Of course, overturning laws can be a slow process, and rolling back Roe v. Wade would likely take time. No, no, it's not going to take much time. It'll be done in 2 years. But in some states, trigger laws could move quickly, and in other places like Texas, lawmakers are actively introducing new trigger laws in anticipation of a reversal. So there they go. You know, the right wing has already got this. This is Koch Brothers stuff, 101, okay? Koch Brothers have had this out there for 10 fucking years at least, working on this. State by state by state. They're ready to go. They get somebody like Donald Trump in there, boom, it's done. 2 years at the most. Over. Try getting that back through the course. If the Supreme Court did overturn Roe, the enforceability of these trigger clauses is complicated and difficult to predict. Cryam explains, for instance, six states, Arkansas, Illinois, Kansas, Kentucky, Missouri, and Ohio, enshrine only their intention to revert back to pre-Roe policies without requiring an automatic switch. Since a number of those legislatures tend to skew conservative, that intention could very quickly become law. There you go. So it doesn't matter what their intent is. If you've got a conservative body, legislative body, then you are going to overturn that son of a bitch, and Roe will be dead in your state. New York, we hang by a thread. The Democrats lead. They hold the Senate, you know, and not by much, but they hold the Senate. They hold the Assembly, but the Senate they hold by one, but not really, because there's six or seven traitors. I call them traitors, Democrats in name only. They were voted in as Democrats, but they have switched to the other side, so it makes the Republicans the majority in the Senate, when in fact the votes say differently. The votes say the Democrats own the Senate, But in reality, Republicans do, because of five or six or seven Democrats in name only that have switched parties. They haven't really switched parties. They just voted with the Republicans. That's all. They don't have to switch parties. They just vote with the Republicans. They flip off the Democrats. Fuck you. I'm going to vote with my Republican buddies over here because I am a Republican and I fooled you bastards and your districts. You know, take that, you voters. And the voters continue to vote them in. Regardless, you know, I don't know how that happens either. Man. But that's people not paying attention is what that is. And Republicans get away with it. Very much so, sadly. Momo, where am I here? Let's try this. I got anything? Okay, we're good. All right. I lost my earphones for a second. We're good. I guess, okay, yeah. All right. Good enough. Going forward, if we can. So, yeah, like I say, New York State Legislature is kind of borderline on this, but we should be able to keep Roe, if the Supreme Court doesn't obviously knock it off. But, I mean, it's, as a state, New York still should be pretty good. But not for long, if more and more, it's election creep as far as these quote-unquote Democrats that keep going over to the other side of the aisle and voting with the Republicans. I mean, it used to be one or two, then three or four, now it's five or six or seven. And before long, it's going to be nine or ten, then forget about it. It might as well become a Republican body, legislative body, and you're toast. But, fortunately, we have the Assembly, which is there's way more districts, obviously, in the Assembly, just like there is on Capitol Hill with the Congress critters, way outnumbering the senators. A million to one, whatever, but same here, but there's way more Democrats in the state assembly than there is in the state senate. So, we got that body holding sway, I guess, over Roe v. Wade. Women of a certain age can tell you the horror stories about the days pre-Roe and pre-birth control when they had friends and relatives who died from unsafe abortions and when they had to operate underground abortion networks to get women the reproductive justice they deserve. It's frightening to know that in a Trump era, the possibility of returning these days could be just one judge away. Yeah, exactly right. Yep, one judge will do it. And that's pretty much see the shining sea. Way that works. There we go. Get that there. Okay, go. One judge away, that's all. The whole thing could topple, no question about it. Sad. It really is. It's just amazing that this nonsense could happen. Hunter on the front page, Maryland lawmakers passed a resolution allowing Attorney General to file suit against Trump's policies. I don't know how the hell you do that. I mean, where is that in any kind of law? In Maryland, the General Assembly has just taken an intriguing new step in the efforts to resist the Donald. Most ridiculous orders. By a party-line vote, they've authorized the state's Democratic Attorney General to sue the federal government over immigration or other policies, whether Republican Governor Larry Hogan wants him to or not. Until Wednesday, Maryland reserved the power to sue the federal government to the governor. Until Wednesday, Maryland reserved the power to sue the federal government to the governor and the General Assembly, one of only eight states that do not grant that autonomy to attorney generals. The joint resolution allows Attorney General Frosch to initiate a lawsuit against the government for a long list of action or inaction that the attorney general judges an infringement of Marylanders' rights. So there you go. I mean, I guess you can sue them. I don't think you're going to go very far. Republicans are, of course, nonplussed by this, with Republican Delaware. Republican delegate, I guess, Pat McDonald, expressing worry that The move will result in retaliation by Trump. If you keep poking him in the eye, are we going to get anything? Maybe not. The resistance keeps resisting. America isn't going to devolve into Trump's preferred brand of nationalism and stupidity without a fight. True. Yeah. I mean, the only thing with this resistance thing, and it's been, it's been going on pretty much since the 21st, or certainly the 20th of January, if not the 21st with the march, the Women's March. But until you do something more positive with that stuff, this quote-unquote resistance, then you've got nothing. Because you got to turn this resistance into activism as far as getting people to a monthly kind of meeting of sorts, or if not monthly, certainly every other month, up until the April, May, June of next year, when you start getting your ducks in a row in terms of the election and getting the GOTV effort to get people to the polls in November. So if that doesn't happen, nothing else matters, really. I mean, you can resist all freaking day long, and the Trump's going to applaud that effort. Thank you for resisting. But guess what? We're going to still stick it up your ass, all right? So take that. You can resist all you want. Until that resistance amounts to currency in the form of votes, well, then it doesn't matter a bit. Joan McCarter on the front page. McConnell agrees with Gorsuch that judges shouldn't be criticized. Then, of course, criticizes the Ninth Circuit judges. Yeah. And trashes the Ninth Circuit judges. Because, of course, they're the liberal bastards out there on the West Coast. The sons of bitches. And thank God. Thank the gods for the Ninth Circuit. Oh, my God. If we didn't have those guys, this country would be toast already. Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell went on MSNBC's Morning Joe Wednesday to really go out on a limb and say that he agrees with Supreme Court nominee Neil Gorsuch that judges shouldn't be attacked. I happen to agree with what Gorsuch said, McConnell said Wednesday. I mean, I think, criticizing members of the judiciary individually is not a good idea. But then again, I hate that fucking Ninth Circuit, those bastards, sons of bitches. They all need to be freaking hanged, every goddamn last one of them. But I do agree with Gorsuch that we do not need to be criticizing judges. Thank you. And then he went on, of course, to attack three individual judges on the Ninth Circuit for upholding a nationwide restraining order on Trump's Muslim ban. Man, thank the gods for that. The case that caused Trump to attack a federal judge, leading to Gorsuch's remarks about how he has had a sad when that happens. Yeah. Yeah, no doubt. Scarborough, that when the Ninth Circuit, I mean, the second I knew I was assigned to the Ninth Circuit. You're absolutely right, Joe. That was McConnell. You're absolutely right, Joe. Scarborough, I said, okay, so we know how they're going to rule. McConnell, yeah. Scarborough, they just acted so shocked. McConnell, I wouldn't be shocked by anything the Ninth Circuit did. Scarborough, right. I mean, we always think of it as a bastion of liberalism, and it has been for a really long time. So no, Scarborough, it reflects the people it represents. It's just like the 11th does or the 5th does. McConnell, yeah, I mean, it reflects the views of the people who got appointed. For the record, here's the panel of three judges who continued to stay on executive order. Judge Richard Clifton, an appointee of George W. Bush. Judge William Canby Jr., an appointee of Jiminy Carter, and Judge Michelle Friedland, an appointee of Barack Obama. They ruled unanimously. That means the Bush appointee, too. And Jimmy Carter, I just can't believe that there's somebody appointed by Jimmy Carter that's still wearing a robe. Holy cow, man. Wow, that's going back. If you were appointed in 78... Yeah, even 77. 77 is 40 years ago, okay? So you're coming off on 40 years of service in the Ninth Circuit. Not that I'm whining or crying, but holy God, that's a long friggin' time to be on a court. Any court, not just that one. But not complaining. They're voting the right way. So he or she can stay another 40 freaking years, as far as I'm concerned. It's just amazing that he must have been like 30 or something when he got appointed. Attention, Coloradans. Representative Mike Kaufman says he wants to hear your ACA stories in person next week. By Jen Hayden on the front page. I like his computer. He's got a picture of his office. He's got a nice computer monitor right there that I could look to. Yeah. I can actually see what I'm doing, maybe. Is Congressman Mike Kaufman getting the message? It was less than 1 month ago that Representative Mike Kaufman bolted out of the side door of his own constituent meeting after the overflow crowd wanted to drive home the message that a repeal of the Affordable Care Act was unacceptable. Kaufman was reportedly overwhelmed by ACA supporting constituents. Here is the video of him escaping his meeting while more than 100 people waited inside, still in line for their turn to talk to the Congress critter. I've had enough of this crap. I'm out of here, bailing out the side door. While more than 100 people were waiting to meet them, Mike Kaufman sneaks out early from his own community event. Representative Kaufman must have gotten the message because his office just announced he will be holding a listening tour in his district next week. Well, yeah, maybe. I think the only message he's got is he better show up once in a while to some of these things. Yeah, and I don't know. I don't know if that means anything or not, but there it is. For what it's worth, I guess that goes under the for what it's worth category. Joe McCarter, in light of the latest Russian news, we should trust Trump with the Supreme Court. Well, of course not, but it doesn't matter. He's going to put the people in there that he wants in there, which is going to be, to the right of Attila the Hun, for the most part, I would think, yeah. And again, you know, we had the opportunity there to get somebody in there from the left side of the aisle and failed epically, in my view. I don't know how we let that slip. I mean, you can blame the Republicans for stalling, but holy cow, man. I think you get out there every day on the bully pulpit and say, this is day 88 of the Republicans stalling on the vote for my nominee. I'm just saying out there, this is day 88, and then the next day, day 89. Day 89 of the stall. I just want to let everybody out there in America know that this is day 89 of the stall, and we're not having none of it, okay? Call your Congress critter, tell him to get off the freaking bench there and start doing something. Nonsense. On Monday, before all Russian hell broke loose at the White House, forcing National Security Advisor Michael Flynn to resign. New York Times published this story on the quandary facing Democrats over Supreme Court nominee Neil Gorsuch. Appease the base or honor the process, the sub. Yeah, how about that? Yeah, let's just appease. What are you going to do? You're just going to appease the base? Or are you going to honor the fucking process and vote for the guy? What the hell are you going to do? Oh, yeah. Because the Republicans are so honorable, you know. But as the nominee judge, Gorsuch goes through this process, goes through the paces on Capitol Hill, keeping a bipartisan schedule of Senate meetings. The process has laid bare the dilemma now facing Democrats at every turn, forcing the party into disparate factions over a nominee with copious credentials but deeply conservative roots. So take that. I don't know how many disparate factions of the Democratic Party is. There should be no disparate faction. There should be one faction, and that is the against vote. That's all. What the hell you're talking about, the disparate factions. How many factions can you have on that? And here's the surprising thing. Minority Leader Chuck Schumer's number two guy, Illinois Senator Richard Durbin. Okay, come on. You can do it. Maybe not. Yeah, surprisingly, Richard German had this to say about it. The base wants me to reject him out of hand, said Senator Richard German of Illinois, the body's number two Democrat, who will meet with Judge Gorsuch on Tuesday. I don't think that serves the country well. Well, fuck you. Then you don't need to be reelected. How about that? Mr. German then added, we've had a handful of Democratic senators who've already announced they're voting no. Many people in some parts of the base think we should all make that announcement. I just don't think that's appropriate. Well, what do you think is appropriate? You think it's appropriate to freaking stall the Obama vote, you freaking asshat? Get off of my freaking porch. God damn it. Get off my lawn, too, damn it. You're out of here. So, Mr. German, care to revisit that statement 2 days later? Has anything happened, anything at all, that might make you think a Trump appointment to the Supreme Court of a guy to the right of both Justice Samuel Alito and Antonin Scalia, still dead, should just be rejected out of hand? Because from out here, that looks like the responsible way forward. Yeah, pretty much. Yep. Antonin Scalia, of course, still dead, but he's going to be even, this guy is even to the right of Antonin Scalia, if that's freaking possible. If that's even possible. I'm trying. I'm still waiting for DK5. That's all. Moment of yourself. Man, I don't even know where the hell I am here. Let me go here. I guess try this. Oh yeah. Okay. Here's something I got here. Okay. Oh, yeah, there we go. Kerry Elleveld on the front page. Republicans block independent inquiry of Kremlingate, which might set bar for all future scandals. There we go. Therefore, there will be no other future scandals. That's the way it works. GOP House Intelligence Chair Devin Nunes pretty much summed up the standard Republican line on launching an independent investigation into the Trump campaign's ties to Russia during an election that was heavily tainted by Russian interference. Allegedly. You need to put that allegedly in there, okay? Allegedly heavily tainted by Russian interference. There's not going to be one. I can tell you there's absolutely not going to be one. And I am not going to be lectured by people who are speaking out on both sides of their ass or mouths. So take that. House Intelligence Chair Devin Nunes with a statement. There's not going to be an investigation. Well, investigations continue behind closed doors in the House and Senate Intelligence Committees. Launching an independent commission would be much more public and impossible for Republicans to control. But while the GOP continues its nothing-to-see-here routine, everyone who isn't a congressional Republican is convinced this is likely the biggest scandal they've seen since Watergate. Take it from a seasoned reporter, an independent senator, and a retired military officer. Veteran journalist Dan Rather, who has a little experience in this arena, called the Trump-Russia story possibly the measure by which all future scandals are judged. In other words, if we think Watergate was big, we ain't seen nothing yet. He wrote on Facebook, Watergate is the biggest political scandal of my lifetime, until maybe now. It was the closest we came to a debilitating constitutional crisis. We came to a debilitating constitutional crisis until maybe now. On a 10 scale of Armageddon for our form of government, I would put Watergate at 9. This Russia scandal is currently somewhere around a 5 or 6, in my opinion, but it is cascading in intensity, seemingly by the hour. And we may look back and see in the end that it is at least as big as Watergate, may become the measure by which all future scandals are judged. It has all the necessary ingredients, and that is chilling. Independent Senator Angus King, who sits on the Senate Intelligence Committee that's currently investigating Russia's 2016 meddling, told NPR the inquiry was the most important work of his life. Yeah, possibly. Oh, yeah. Take a look more of this. Yeah, this is something that's never happened in American history. This is very, very gravely serious stuff. This is probably the most important work I've ever done in my life, said the Senator Angus King. I don't know. I don't quite get the whole sense of it. I don't think it's anywhere near Watergate. But maybe it is. Maybe Dan Rather has it right. I don't know. I don't think there's any there. I don't see any there, but I guess Dan Rather does. King is likely getting a sense of where things are headed here. He said the Senate committee has already been in touch with the federal agencies involved in the Russia inquiry and identified the staff and documents on which to focus. Then there's this assessment from retired Army Colonel Peter Mansour, a former aide to General David Petraeus. It's astonishing for a campaign to have contacts with senior intelligence officials of another nation, a strategic adversary of the U.S., and then for the incoming National Security Advisor to discuss sanctions that are being imposed on that country by the outgoing administration. You know, it's just breathtaking. We saw this was happening in front of everybody's eyes. It wasn't like it was behind the curtain or something. This was taking place. You know, we were talking about it on MSLSD and all the other cable nets that, Flynn and some of the other people are involved in this. Blah 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 blah. You know, it's man, I don't know. I would have thought that it would have been a sanction right there. Something should have been happening right there to sanction that. But nothing did. I mean, nobody really complained about it. And President Obama should have come out right out and said, hey, this is a bunch of crap. You know, I mean, you don't want to ruin the incoming administration before they even get started, but they're trampling all over your policy. So I would have said something needs to be done about this. This has never taken place except when Ronald Reagan did it. But, it's incomprehensible. People, you know, that is, it's just breathtaking, like you said. But, I mean, it was out in the open. It wasn't like it was behind the curtain. This Ronald Reagan stuff was behind the curtain. This was right out in the open. They came right in there after November 8th election and said, hey, wait, yeah, we are. Forget Obama, you know, next 9-10 weeks. We are the presidency, okay? And we are going to do this. And they did. They did it right in front of everybody. So, I don't know, until somebody says no or steps, you know, smacks them in the head or smacks them upside the head. They continue to march. They say, hey, we got away with that. Let's try to get away with this. We got away with that. Let's go to Russia. Let's try to get away. We got away with that. I guess we can do any goddamn thing we want, apparently. And they do. And they are. Because nobody said anything. And the press should have said something. The press, yeah, I know. It's mainstream press. But they should have had said, wait a second. This is unprecedented. And I don't know how this is getting, you know, I don't know how this is even taking place. But nope, nobody said a damn thing. And if nobody says something, you're good to go. And as far as I'm concerned, this whole thing, if nobody said something during the, you know, December, back in December when this was going on, or January when this was going on, early weeks of January, then clear. He's clear. There's no crime been committed here. Hillary Clinton's former campaign manager, Robbie Mook, called the similarities between Watergate and Kremlin eerie after running through a quick timeline of events. The DNC was broken into by Russian intelligence. The materials that, no, they weren't. They were leaked. They weren't broken into by Russian intelligence. They were leaked to Russian intelligence. Okay, somebody leaked that stuff. There was no hack. There was no hack job. Russia did not hack into the DNC. Somebody from the DNC leaked this crap. The materials that they stole from the DNC were handed over to WikiLeaks for the purpose of hurting Hillary Clinton and helping Donald Trump. The intelligence community has confirmed that. And now that what we're learning is that at the time that this was taking place, officials on the Trump campaign were speaking with Russian officials, and that was that was picked up by our intelligence community because they regularly monitor communications by intelligence officials in Russia. Everyone should be incredibly alarmed by this situation. Well, we weren't in December or January, so why should we be now? And like I say, the Russian didn't hack anything, and they claim they didn't hack anything, and there's no evidence that they did hack anything. the information is that this all this email information from the DNC was leaked to whomever and ended up in the hands of WikiLeaks. I don't know. I mean, I don't think that's any. If it's a crime, it's somebody from their own party. I think that did perform the leak is what's going on here. I don't know how Russia's involved in any of this, really. Other than the timing, I guess. I guess maybe I'm missing something here. But I don't see it. Unless Russia actually did hack the DNC, then maybe you got an argument. And maybe something should have, maybe they did pick up on something. But I don't think there's ever been any evidence presented that says, hey, yes indeed, the Russians did indeed hack DNC computers, blah, 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 blah. No, I've never heard that. Never read it. The only thing I know is the only way that WikiLeaks got this stuff is somebody leaked it from the DNC. So it had nothing to do with Russia, really. The only thing that has nothing to do with Russia is the timing of the incidents with, this leak. And then you got the Trumpsters talking to Russia officials. I don't know why they were even talking to Russian officials, but that's, they're setting up. I think they're doing the same thing that Obama did as president in 2012, running for re-election, saying, hey, wait, I can't do nothing until I get re-elected here. So wait till I get re-elected, and then we'll talk about it, okay? They've already, Trump's already been elected. He's saying, hey, wait, I gotta wait till, Obama's out of office, and then we're gonna do this, and this. I don't think there's anything illegal about that. Unless it totally goes against American policy, which maybe it did. I don't know. I have no idea. Arian Deeb, apparently not enough of an astonishing once-in-a-lifetime bar-setting scandal to warrant an independent investigation. Instead, Majority Leader Mitch McConnell wants you to know that Democrats still haven't confirmed Trump's entire cabinet, which, by the way, just might have been nominated by a president who collaborated with a foreign power to win the election. I don't think so. I don't think any of that's true. I don't think Trump collaborated with anybody, including the Russians, to win that election. But forget about the last part. It's Democrats who really need to do their job, says McConnell. Yeah, I don't get it. I don't get this whole connection here with Russia and, the election. Russia and the election. I don't get it. Let me get this straight. They wanted to make sure the Trumpster won, so they leaked all the email crap from Hillary Clinton and all the DNC, blah, blah, blah. Maybe. I don't know. Maybe there's a conspiracy there, but I don't see it. I need more evidence than what I've seen so far. And maybe there is. Maybe the intelligence services have all that information. I don't know. How do I know? Just to me, it seems like this is sour grapes on the part of the Hillary Clinton campaign. Say, hey, we was robbed, damn it. The Russians robbed us. That was your FBI head that robbed you. Broke that story 2 weeks before the campaign, or 2 weeks before the election, or even before that, 10 days. 10 days before the election, breaking that email story. That's what robbed you, if anything. But it had nothing to do with the Russians. I don't get this whole Russian connection. Maybe, I don't know. I don't see it. Might be there. There might be something there, but I don't see it. I don't know. All right, this one, we got a couple more minutes here. No, we don't want to do that. Go here. DK5 is killing me. Oh, yeah, okay. I don't know what to do. Okay, this is Kelly Messias. Is that her name? No conservatives. Betsy DeVos is absolutely not the new Ruby Bridges. I don't know who Ruby Bridges is. But Betsy DeVos is not it. Poor Betsy got briefly blocked from entering a school last week. And now conservatives want to make her a martyr. Yeah, there you go. Boy, this whole education thing is killing me. The other issue that I... One issue voter is education. This whole freaking privatizing education. Charter schools, blah, 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 blah. Robbing money from the public education system to pay for private private schools, charter schools, you name it, homeschools, blah, 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 blah. Totally undermining the country, basically. The way I look at it, I mean, that's where you get your, you know, K through six or whatever, K, you know, elementary school is where you get your, most of your education is about where this, I mean, not most of it, but I mean, you get your start as far as education goes. It's how, where you're from, what you're doing, where, you know, what country you live in, what state you live in, what city you live in, blah, 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 blah. It's all civics oriented. You know, they all also throw in math, science, and reading, writing, arithmetic, all that's good stuff too. But I mean, man, oh man, they just want to flush that. We don't need no stinking science, damn it. And the worst part is, of course, they rob the public trough to pay for their own school. So it's a twofer for the right wing is what it is, this whole education thing. Number one, they take money out of the public trough, out of the public reserves, whatever, public treasury, and use that money to build their private schools. So it's a twofer. They get a free school, you know, and they fuck the public schools at the same time. So, man, you can't beat that. If you're a right winger, that's the way to go. Hey, you know, hey, if I got something for you here, if you want to build a private school, go ahead. Just call it a charter school and take funds out of the public school system to build your school and pay for your teachers and yada, yada, yada. Don't worry about it. The taxpayers won't even notice, okay? This is by, Kelly Messias, whatever, I can't write my way. To state the obvious, we have a problem with racism in this country. We don't fully understand its complexity, and we struggle to talk about it. Adding to the problem is the fact that conservatives are notorious for calling out everything and anything as racist, except actual racism itself. You know, and racism today, I know there's the under 30 crowd that's still, there's some still 30, under 30 people that wear racism on their sleeve, whatever. But for the most part, it's the over 30 crowd that still has a thing for racism, blah, blah, blah. And really, it's more of the over 50 crowd, really, that is still has some of that wearing it on their sleeve thing for most everybody. Nobody gives a flying flip about, you know, the people I bump into every day, very few, including African Americans. I don't care what color you're talking about, what people of color you're talking about. None of them care about that. The ones I bump into, anyway, it's just, I don't know, maybe I'm just not seeing something, but I just, holy cow. White, black, blue, green, doesn't matter what color you are. Nobody really cares today about what skin color you have, you're wearing. In today's lesson on what is not and will never be actual racism, conservatives have compared protesters blocking the entrance of Betsy DeVos from a school in Washington, D.C. to the experience of Ruby Bridges, the first black child to desegregate William France Elementary School in New Orleans in 1960. Damn it, take that, you racist bastards. You've likely seen Norman Rockwell's painting, The Problem We All Live With, inspired by how then 60-year-old Bridges was escorted to and from schools by U.S. Marshals due to threats of violence from angry white mobs. This is one of the most famous images from the Civil Rights Movement. And not a bad painting, I might say. I don't, you know, I just never could get paintings. I don't know how you can put that much detail on a canvas with a paintbrush. I just don't get it. Yeah, pen and pencil, yeah, you can put detail, but a paintbrush? How do you put that much detail on a paintbrush? I don't, you know, how do you do that? it takes a lot of friggin' skill like that. To give some context, the crowd that surrounded the school on a daily basis were a group of pro-segregationist white mothers called the cheerleaders. They threw things, shouted obscenities, and even put a black baby doll in a coffin and protested with it outside of the school. They kept this up for the entire school year. Walter Cronkite reported the incident in 1960 for the Evening News, so the national coverage gave the American people, including Rockwell, all the horrible details, including eggs being thrown by segregationist housewives, words that were so bad that the censors had to muffle the crowd noise and blot these hurtful, horrible words out of their coverage. Historian Kevin Cruz gives a great breakdown on Twitter of this history. Apparently, Rockwell was so disturbed by the scenes from New Orleans that he couldn't bring himself to paint the crowds. John Steinbeck, who happened to be in New Orleans at the time and saw the crowds in person, had this to say about them. No newspaper had printed the words these women shouted. It was indicated that they were indelicate. Some even said obscene. On television, the soundtrack was made to blur or had crown noises cut to occur. But I heard the words bestial and filthy and degenerate. But apparently last week, while the rest of us saw a group of protesters blocking the very unqualified DeVos from entering into a public school in D.C., conservatives saw this. Draw a picture of the same picture that Rockwell has painted, but with DeVos as the center character rather than the little six-year-old girl. It's amazing, really. Not even close, of course, to reality, but that's their reality. Their reality is that, exactly, because that's the way their friggin' brain works. The writer is actually comparing the experience of a six-year-old black child whose family risked her life to participate in the integration of the New Orleans school system to a spoiled white billionaire who got the education secretary gig by buying her way in and will do everything to trash public school system. But again, conservatives want you to believe that's the same as this. If history is any judge, blockading schoolhouse doors to keep people out makes you the villain, not the hero. Exactly. Sean Davis, Twitter, man. Astonishing, isn't it? What an insult to Ruby Bridges and to civil rights activists who have encountered actual racism. And of course, DeVos actually did make it into the school later and still remains our Secretary of Education. But who knows? Maybe she will need to see a psychologist for the trauma that was inflicted on her that day. And maybe the therapist, if they're any good, can finally help her figure out the difference between proficiency and growth. Damn it. Take that. Man. And what's even sadder is the six-year-old schoolgirl is younger than I am, and I'm sure still around today. Man. Going back that far. And still young. I'm younger than me still. Sad. Okay. Man. Fun just the same. So yeah, DeVos is a nightmare, and not just her, but of course her husband, billionaire. Is there anything here going on there? Yeah, maybe not. Let me try this. Got a couple minutes. Might be able to sneak something in real quick. No, I guess we don't. I guess we're out of time. Son of a gun. We got about 30 seconds. We got to get out of here. But KGRX in the morning kicks it off. So do that. Tune it in 9 o'clock Eastern time. 6 o'clock out over there on the West Coast. And we follow that up, of course, with the after show at 11. So bring it on. Bring it on tomorrow. Out of here. Back here Sunday night, same bad time. We'll do it again. Thanks for tuning in. We're out.